thank you for having me. Can you just confirm if I'm audible, I'm visible?
Yes, yes, you are.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. I want you all to do something for me. I want you to look back at your life and try to think about that one moment when you felt like you were at your creative best, when you felt what is known as that spark, when you were able to see the world in a way that you haven't seen before and you have created something that did not exist. What happened at that moment? What happened in your brain that allowed you to do that, to write that poem, to make that song, to sketch that painting? I'm Dr. Siddharth Warrier, and today we will be discussing some of the mysteries of the neuroscience of creativity. And the way we will do this is by talking about some of the myths of creativity that we have been led to believe. Myth number one, there is one part of the brain that makes you creative, the so-called creative center of the brain. This is false. And in order to understand why this is false, we need to understand how the brain works. We perceive the environment, we perceive the universe through our senses. We see things, hear things, touch things. All of these enter our brain and go to the top of the brain. And when I say top, it is an acronym for temporo-occipito-parietal area. So these are the three lobes of the brain, the three areas of the brain that deal with sensory information. The top of the brain takes all the sensory information, processes them, puts it together, and gives us the sense of reality that we see around us. But it's not enough to just take in information. We also have to do something. We have to interact with the environment. So this top area sends this information to the front of the brain, called as the frontal lobe. And this is where the motor cortex is situated. And from the motor cortex, the nerves come down to your hands, to your legs, to your fingers, and we are able to interact with the environment. We have a motor output. This is the most primitive loop, the loop of input, processing, and output. This is how we move through our environment, and this is the basis of the biological conversation of evolution. As this loop keeps improving, the efficiency of our interaction with the environment keeps increasing. But we are not robots, so the things that we take in also affect us personally. This is where the second loop comes in, the loop at the center of our brain called as the emotional loop. And this involves a part of the brain called as the limbic system. And this is loop number two. So there are two loops, one on the outside interacting with the environment and one on the inside dealing with our own emotions. The way these two loops interact decides your thoughts, your behavior, your actions. Now, whether you are making a cup of coffee or whether Leonardo da Vinci is painting the Mona Lisa, it is the same loops of the brain that are interacting, the same neurons that are working. The only difference is how the neurons talk to each other. In what patterns do they connect, do they fire with each other, decides whether you end up with a cup of coffee or you end up with the most famous painting in the world. And that is how myth number one is wrong, that there is no one area of the brain. When Dorothy Parker wanted to say that if I leave somebody, it hurts far more than when someone leaves me, she said, love is for unlucky folk. Love is but a curse. Once there was a heart I broke, and that I think is worse. Same concept, same words, but language is a great example of how words can form patterns that are unexpected and therefore create magic and poetry. Myth number two is one that you would all be familiar with, which is the right side of the brain is more creative. Now, this comes because of so many pop culture references. There have been stories, there have been plays, jokes written on how the right side is creative and the left side is logical. And this comes from this pre-existing notion that the object recognition happens on the left side and pattern recognition happens on the right. Now, there is definitely some specialization, but it is not so clear cut. And creativity is not either object recognition or pattern recognition. It is actually a dance. It is a dance between the way we see objects and how they interact. And the more our pattern recognition evolves, the more our object recognition evolves. So the same words will look different to us as we start writing poetry. The next myth that we have to debunk is the idea that creativity comes from defocused attention. That is, when we step back, there is creativity. And this stems from the idea that creativity is divergent, so-called thinking out of the box. Now, this has been proven true and false because there is a comfort zone that we all operate in. One area that we are very comfortable in, and when we step out of it, we tend to look at things differently. But convergent thinking, or rather bringing things into the box, has been proven to be equally effective for creativity. So if you are somebody who is uncomfortable in thinking out of the box, change the way you think and think of bringing in more things into your box, and you will find yourself getting more and more creative. And the last myth is that drugs, alcohol, they tend to make you more creative. And this is the most dangerous myth of all, highlighted by stories of rock stars doing drugs or alcoholic novelists. But the statistics that show that the number of drug addicted artists versus artists who don't abuse alcohol, and the number of people who do drugs and who end up not creating something, should be enough proof that drugs and alcohol is not the answer for creativity. But there is a lesson in there though. Where does that come from? One of our earlier speakers, Prakhar Gupta, talked about the importance of courage in creativity. And it is not easy to break the comforting bonds of pre-existing patterns. Any state of altered sensorium, whether it is dreaming or sleepy or daydreaming or drugged or drunk, all of these are altered states of consciousness, and they allow the bonds of discipline to be loosened up. And when the bonds of discipline loosen up, there is chaos in your thoughts. Neurons start connecting to each other in unexpected ways. And in chaos, anything can happen, including art. But you are not in control of that. And this brings me to what I personally believe is the closest definition to creativity. Creativity is controlled chaos. When you have the capacity to allow your neurons to connect to each other in a way that they have not connected before, but all the while you have the ability to step in and shape the outcome as and when you please. That, I feel, is creativity. And this does not happen overnight. It is a long process involving practice, courage, curiosity, and the ability to take lots of feedback. But I think it is a journey worthy of our effort. From a personal standpoint, as a doctor who has spent the last 15, 16 years in a medical hospital doing my residency, this idea of art, creativity, poetry has always been as an extracurricular activity, something that you do outside of your normal life. You have to find a little bit of time in a corner of your room to incorporate this. But after reading about neuroscience, I've realized that life is a lot like the brain. And just like the myths of neuroscience, the myths of life also has to be debunked. There is no one part of your life for creativity, just like there's no one part of the brain for creativity. Your whole brain comes together to work as a unified structure to help you create. And similarly, your whole life is a platform for your creativity to shine through. I hope that this has reached some of you, and I hope that you allow your brain to explore the way it wants to. Thank you.